Just a handful survive. Enlist ye Newfoundlanders and come follow me.
And it's over the mountains and over the seas. Come brave Newfoundlanders and join the Puppeteers. You'll find the Holly in Flanders and act in the police. Enlist ye Newfoundlanders and come follow me.
And this again.
Two, three, four.
The stone men on Water Street still cry for the day that the pride of this city went marching away. 1,000 men slaughtered to hear the king say, enlist ye Newfoundlanders and come follow me. Everybody!
And it's over the mountains and over the seas. Go hey, Newfoundlanders and join the Puppeteers.
Thank you.
CLB. For the sons of the merchants who joined the Blue Petites, with all hands enlisted, 500 young men. Enlist ye Newfoundlanders and come follow me. Across the broad Atlantic in the brave Florizel, and on the sands of Silva, they entered in town, and on the flooded beaches, first I met in town. Enlist ye Newfoundlanders and come follow me. The next thing you know, I'm sitting on my arse 15 feet from where I was, with me boots blown clean off. And the funny thing was, these socks were nowhere to be found. So I just sat there, laughing my arse off. I look over at the guy that walked next to me. Suddenly, my socks no longer seem so funny. That poor bastard was blown clean in half as he was sputtering and gurgling in his lap.
bright eyes, same shock of red hair, same round, freckled face. You know, he pulled me a kiss as he marched by. What a cheeky bugger. The day dragged on in a haze of the broken, the bleeding, and the dead. Each was seen and each was sorted. That one could wait. That one next in line. That one critical. And that one beyond help. A sad collection of ranked men and boys. A regiment of pain. As I worked, I continually cleansed my hands of the blood and gore. I became numb. Mechanical. Professional. I remember there was a break. Mid-afternoon, and I stepped outside to get a breath of fresh air. And I looked down the field of flowers.
It's like being a movie star or something.
Yeah, I mean, Tyrone Power, Errol Flynn, and the Duke.
John Wayne.
It was gonna be great. The officer down at the recruiting office said, women don't mind the red beret. So I signed up. I went home. My mom cried. My dad got one of those attaboy looks. And my grandpa just shook his head. You see, he'd been in the big war back in 17. And he talked to me about it. They'd always be short, awkward conversations with me doing most of the talking. One time, he said that being a soldier was like waiting to tightrope over Niagara. Pretty boring stuff until they went to go over the top. But when they went over, two things happened. Officers made mistakes, and people, a lot of people, got killed. So he told me this one piece of information that I didn't quite understand until I survived my first action. He said, to operate as a soldier should, I need to think of myself already dead. And that way, I can focus on the task at hand and not worry about tomorrow. The next day, we all went down to the train station, and as the train pulled away, my grandpa was the only one not waving goodbye. I guess to him, until I came home, I was already dead. Strange old guy.
We were all so proud. So many
Chinese guys trying to kill us all the time. I agree with my mom. It's stupid. That's life, right, Joe?
Oh, yeah. That's life. My name is Brian. You just got right with Bronco. Because if Bronco kicks you off, you're going to get stronger. That's what life is. They'll kick you down, and they'll kick you, and kick you again, and they play again. So you just have to ride the Bronco, hold on as long as you can, and just don't get anything.
busted up piece of crap party, you go. So, crew has to change the name of crew go. Weird stuff like that. One thing they all have in common is we're all killers. Every last one of them. They seem to enjoy it like some kind of sick, twisted Olympic event. Had a point system. You kill a kid, you get some points. Blow an arm off some little girl, get some points. Wipe out an entire family. Hit the jackpot. One time, he was on patrol outside this little zone on the Serbs and the Croats were both fighting over. They come across this Serbian soldiers smoking a marble in front of a line of neatly piled bodies in front of a machine gun riddled house. I still remember the hand-painted sign, the colorful letters for the Bosnian word for welcome hanging off the front door. As we got out of the APC, we realized there's an entire family line. Dad, mom, two little girls, baby. So I walk up to the guy and ask, hey, do you speak English? Takes a slow drag from his cigarette. He spits in front of the bottle.
Dad.
What the hell happened here? I mean, it's kind of obvious that this creep was responsible. I mean, he had a smile on his face, like a hunter standing over his day's kills. I mean, this bastard was actually proud of what he'd done. I wanted to grab him, I wanted to shake him, I wanted to punch him until nothing in this world's worth what he's done to these people. For all I got out. Why in God's name did you do this? And he just stares at me. Some simple child said,
go home, Canada. God does not live here anymore.
And he flicks his cigarette around the bodies. He walks away. And then,
join hands, dance the sprightly polo, stand in
live my life so that others may live in peace. I give my life so that children, like our own, can grow up happy and play in the sun. I give my life so that husbands and wives can grow old together and smile and laugh and love. Darling, it is so hard to say goodbye. was my first action. And to this day, I have no idea how I survived. And on that awful friggin' day, air thick with lead, half my unit gets shot up, and I get out without even a scratch. Go figure. Luck, fate, divine intervention, who knows? Of course, why'd the old man upstairs want to save my sorry ass? Looking back, I can still remember every detail. It's clear, like a movie in my head. I can even remember the smell of the transport. Fuel, chewing tobacco, gun grease, and sweat. Helmand Prop. Man, what a dump. I remember my granddad used to describe parts of Korea as close to the edge of the earth that you can get without falling off. That was Helmand. Sand, scrub, brush, blasted landscape all around. Why anyone would want to live there? It's beyond me. So, we're sitting in the transport, and I'm the new guy, the NFG. And I'm scared. Trying real hard to look salty and failing miserably. I look around and everybody's loose. How do they do that? Joking around or talking hockey, you know what their kids are doing, or bitching about their wives. And I'm trying real hard not to lose my lunch. I can't remember what my granddad used to tell me about combat. Rely on your sergeant, your buddies, your training, and in that order, you'll be okay. He should know. He was 17 in Korea, later a peacekeeper. He used to say he got shot at by folks on three different continents. Real life. I remember looking over my sergeant. Hey, Sergeant. He's sitting there with this bored look on his face, and you'd think he was going to the mall with his wife. I'm fidgeting and checking my weapon, and he's just sitting there. Finally, he comes over and sits down next to me and puts his hand on mine and says,
"Relax, breathe. That's the ticket."
He got me talking, and soon I was telling him about my dad, my granddad, both pounders like me. He said that with people like that, I had nothing to worry about, because I was a warrior, right down to my boots. Think about Helmand was that you never really knew who was shooting at you. Local Taliban teenager with a death wish. Some foreign groups of fighters from Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, Egypt, some guys from Yemen, or even freaking Chechens. Chechens? What the hell are they doing here? Of course, you could also get shot at by some local farmer defending his poppy field with an ancient AK-47. Did I forget to mention that this is one of the prime producers of heroin in the world? So anyway, we hop off, and there we were. Patrolling the helmet. It was so quiet. The only thing I could hear, besides my boots crunching in the sand, radio chatter, was some goat in the distance complaining about something. We neared this wreck from the village to have a chat with some of the local elders, when it all went down the crapper. Ambush! We walked right into it. The only thing that saved us was Timmy Taliban, the little leader. And instead of drawing us into the open, RPGs, let the machine guns cross. The RPG rocket just above my head. I can feel the heat and stuff all at the same time. Three guys go down, and everybody starts shooting at once. God, it was so loud. And this hurricane of noise to somebody else.
Get down!
I'm firing my weapon.
down. Was sad. Half his face just blown away. He's staring at me with lifeless eyes. I sit there for what seems a long time. It's been a sergeant. What's his name? At this point, I can't remember. He saved my life.